Okay, our next chapter is light as a probability wave. We learned that light is an electromagnetic wave. Electric field as a function of space and time is E naught, the amplitude, times sinus kx minus omega t. K is the wave vector, omega the angular frequency, 2 pi over lambda and 2 pi above a capital T. Speed of light was 1 divided square root of epsilon naught mu naught, or frequency times lambda. In the last chapter, we learned that light has particle properties. Photoelectric effect showed us what's the energy of light. Planck constant times frequency. And now let me really be specific with this keyword quantization of energy here. So the light spectrum is continuous. And here I mean the wavelength or the frequency. So continuous spectrum of light means, in simple, straightforward words, the color spectrum of light, the rainbow colors of light. So you can tune the colors of light continuously. There are no lines or gaps in between. Continuous spectrum of light, wavelength, or frequency, because as you know, speed of light is wavelength times frequency. This is continuous. Quantized is actually the transfer of energy of light to the electrons. Quantized transfer of energy to the electrons. This was the case in our experiment, the photoelectric effect. So don't mix that up. Finally, we did confirm that light has a momentum. And this is mass times speed of light. And if light has a momentum, there's also a mass associated with it. Energy is Planck constant times frequency is mc squared. And here again, let me be very precise in my wording here. Light, a photon, has no mass at rest. However, when light travels, it possesses an energy, h times f, and that energy can be associated with the mass. That's the wave-particle duality. And once again, you have to be very precise here. When light travels, it behaves like an electromagnetic wave. It has a certain energy. Mass at rest is zero. When light gets absorbed, it disappears. The photon completely disappears. When a photon hits an electron in the Compton effect, you get an elastic scattering event. This is really like a particle, a photon hitting another particle, an electron, and you get elastic scattering. So in the moment of this scattering event, light behaves like a particle, like a photon. So be very precise here. And the most extreme case, mass cannot travel with the speed of light. When light travels, it behaves like pure energy. Electrons on the other side, you can accelerate them as much as you can. Each time you have to pump energy in, but its final velocity will never reach the speed of light. So this is actually the final statement here. Light wave particle duality. This is what we have proven experimentally in the photoelectric effect and Compton effect. So there's another approach how you could actually look at that. And this is actually, you can treat light as a probability wave. And that rule is the probability per unit time and interval that a photon will be detected in a small volume centered on a given point in a light wave is proportional to the square of the amplitude of its wave electric field. Let me write this down. The probability per unit time and time interval that a photon will be detected in any small volume centered on a given point centered on a given point in a light wave is proportional to E squared, the amplitude of the wave's electric field vector squared. probability wave, that sounds a bit strange at the moment. However, you will soon realize that this is indeed an excellent approach towards the understanding of quantum mechanics. So, E squared, let me recall Poynting vector. The intensity of light can be associated with the Poynting vector, which is 1 over mu naught E cross B, electric and magnetic field, or C naught over mu naught E squared. And what we are now saying is the probability function to be precise, the probability density is P, and this is E squared or E naught squared sine squared kx minus omega t. That's the definition of the probability density of a light wave, light as a particle wave in that case. And let me stop here. Again, a quick break to clean the board. So, particle wave duality of light, electromagnetic wave, and particle properties. What about matter? What about an electron? What about a neutron, a proton, or entire atoms? They are clearly particles, but do they also have wave properties? And the amazing thing is, yes, indeed, electrons and neutrons have wave properties. They behave like matter waves. I can tell you that right away from my everyday life, and I'll show you some PowerPoint slides about it. I'm doing neutron scattering, neutron diffraction. Keyword diffraction, remember, implies we have a constructive and destructive superposition of waves. I'm doing neutron diffraction here at ANSTO, Lucas Heights. It's 30-35 minutes car drive away from the university. Depends on the M5 traffic jam every day. They are running a 20 megawatt research reactor. It's a nuclear reactor, the only nuclear reactor in Australia. This reactor also produces neutrons, and we neutron scientists are using the neutron as particle wave to determine through Bragg's law diffraction on single crystal to determine materials properties. Comment from my own, about my own person, I'm not a nuclear scientist, not at all. I'm a material scientist, condensed matter physics. I'm using the neutron to determine properties of a material like the precise crystallographic or magnetic structure. That's done by diffraction, Bragg's law, and it only works because neutrons have wave properties. Matter waves, chapter 3.15. And this is the so-called de Broglie wavelength. Louis de Broglie, de Broglie, to be precise, a French scientist, 1892 till 1987 in France. And he got the Nobel Prize in 1928. And he figured out that even matter like electrons, neutrons, even entire atoms or molecules have wave properties. And here, the momentum can be expressed as follows. Momentum is Planck constant divided by lambda. This is how you can calculate the de Broglie wave. Classical momentum is mass times velocity. I'll show you an example about that. So, the experimental proof would be electron or neutron diffraction. Here, diffraction is only possible if we have constructive or destructive superposition of waves. Superposition of waves. And what we do in crystallography, we shine waves with a wavelength in the range of angstrom onto a single crystal. Atomic distances are typically in the same order. 2, 3 at angstroms as well. And in that case, Bragg's law can be used. Two D sinus theta is N lambda. This rule can be used to precisely determine the crystal structure of our material, and for neutron scattering, even the magnetic structure, because a neutron itself has its own magnetic moment. Electron diffraction, neutron diffraction, a direct one-by-one proof. We have prepared a short video for you where we are showing electron diffraction right here in this classroom. We have a glowing cathode, similar to the X-ray tube at the first glance. Here, cathode. We heat it up, we apply a high current. At a certain temperature, electrons are emitted and are leaving this wire. You have a plate capacitor-like assembly here with a certain voltage, kilovolt range, This accelerates now the electrons. We have an electron beam. This electron beam hits a small sample here. Hits a sample. In the experiment which we are showing you, it's actually graphite. We get diffraction. Bragg's law. Our sample is actually polycrystalline. It's not a perfect single crystal. It consists of tiny crystallites, which are random oriented. Random oriented small crystals. That's actually the usual form of any material. If you have a piece of copper or a piece of iron in your hands, a copper wire, it's not a copper single crystal, but under an microscope, electron microscope in best case, you can see that there are nanometer to micrometer sized single crystals, and each crystallite is randomly oriented. So if this is our entire material, consists of small crystallites all over, and each crystal has a random orientation to its next neighbor. Because of these random oriented crystals, we get in the end concentric rings on our screen. We have an scintillating screen here. And we get distinct rings. Top view is the central spot here, and then concentric rings. And each ring corresponds one special atomic distance. So again, 2D sinus theta is n lambda. Due to the geometry of our crystal, we will actually see different atomic layers with different atomic distances, distance between these atomic layers. That's why we see two strong lines here. The separation between the lines is actually sinus theta, given by the geometry of this tube. What about the energy now again? The particle energy is the classical particle, 1/2 m of the electron b squared, or momentum squared divided by 2 times mass of the electron. Now we can substitute the de Broglie wavelength into this expression, and we get Planck constant squared divided by 2 times mass of the electron times lambda squared. And if we want to calculate the wavelength is, now we put everything on the other side, is h divided by 2 times mass of the electron times the energy square root. This is our wavelength. In the experiment, the kinetic energy of the electrons, sorry, that's not a super precise picture, should be here direct beam. Sorry for that. The kinetic energy of the electrons is directly the applied voltage here. So if you apply 5,000 volt, 5 kilovolt, the kinetic energy is directly 5,000 electron volt times charge of the electron, 1.6 times 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb. That's directly the kinetic energy, and from that we can calculate the wavelength. Now a simple question: if we increase the voltage here, the accelerating voltage, do the rings here shrink or expand? We increase the kinetic energy, what happens to the rings, to the diameter of the rings? Will they shrink or will they expand? Look at this equation here. Well, it's pretty straightforward. If we increase the energy, it's 1 divided by energy, so lambda decreases, and therefore the angle theta decreases. So with increasing energy, the diameter of these rings will decrease. And this is what we have also shown in this experimental video. Please look out, watch out for this video. And last but not least, what do we really learn from this experiment? It's a direct, visible proof for you that electrons behave like waves. Particle wave, electrons have wave properties. So at the moment, my apology, you have to believe me that we did a proper experiment here, but in the next term, hopefully when you are back, you will have a chance also to do this experiment on your own in the higher year teaching lab. Thank you very much for that part. Okay, back after a quick break for cleaning the board. So let me now summarize here again. How can we convert the kinetic energy of a particle into its wavelength? The kinetic energy is classical mechanics, 1/2 mE v squared. Let me please put here the mass of the electron at the moment, but it could be also a neutron or entire atoms, even larger molecules. This is momentum squared divided by 2 times mass. And now we can substitute the de Broglie wavelengths, the expression for the momentum, de Broglie equation in here, and we get h squared over 2 times mass of the electron times wavelength squared. If we want to calculate the wavelength, wavelength now is h divided by 2 times mass of the electron and energy square root of it. Let me now give you a direct conversion for electrons or neutrons. Direct conversion, wavelength given in angstrom would be 150.4 divided by the energy given in electron volt, here the square root of it. So direct conversion, 1 angstrom would correspond to a kinetic energy of 150.4 electron volt. This is how you can convert electron waves and determine directly their wavelength. For neutrons, wavelength given in angstrom is 81.8, yes, correct, divided by the energy given in milli electron volt, square root. So one angstrom neutron wavelength is 81.8 milli electron volt. So that would be a direct conversion of the neutron or electron wavelength into energy and vice versa. Let's wait here for a moment and stop. Neutron, the energy for one angstrom is in the milli electron range, and for electrons, in the electron volt range. That's a factor of 1,000 difference, roughly. Factor 2,000 different bit from here to here. Why do we have that difference between electrons and neutrons? The reason is pretty simple. It's the mass. An electron mass and a neutron mass, the difference between both of them is 1,836. So the mass ratio, 1,836, is directly reflected here in the ratio between both energies. This is the energy for electrons and neutrons, energy conversion into wavelength. And let me now please highlight again for light, X-ray, this X-ray equation does not hold at all. Don't mix this up. The energy of light is directly H times F, Planck constant times frequency, or H bar omega. And the momentum of light was mass times C naught, wavelength, and frequency, speed of light is lambda times F. Do not mix up the expressions for light with the expressions for particle wave. You will get a complete different and actually wrong result. This is very important. And in the end of this chapter, with the Broglie wavelengths, I wanted to calculate for you how this energy conversion really works. So let's take a wavelength of 2.346 angstrom. I did choose this number actually because that's the wavelength which we use most of the time for our neutron diffraction experiment here at ANSTO. Neutron scattering. So we have to look at the neutron mass. The mass of a neutron is 1.675 times 10 to the power of minus 27 kilogram. Let's plug that in. The momentum of a neutron is the Broglie wavelength h over lambda. Planck constant 6.626 times 10 to the power of minus 34 J joule times second divided by wavelength 2.346 times 10 to the power of minus 10 meter. Joule is kilogram times meter squared by second squared. We have another second here and a meter here. So if that partly cancels out and we get kilogram times meter per second. If you plug that into your calculator, you get, and let me please read that here from the paper, 2.824 times 10 to the power of minus 24 kilogram meter per second. This is the momentum. Out of curiosity, how fast are our neutrons traveling? Velocity. Velocity, momentum is mass times velocity, therefore velocity is momentum divided by mass. We got 2.824 times 10 to the power of minus 24 kilogram meter per second. Mass, again, 1.675 times 10 to the power of minus 27 kilogram, and that gives 1,686 meter per second, or 6,070 kilometer per second. That's the velocity, kinetic velocity of our neutrons. And this is actually amazing, because that's a speed which a missile or a jet fighter would reach. We are actually doing also small angle scattering neutron experiments. And in small angle neutron scattering experiments, we are using even longer wavelength. And here, the velocity of the neutrons is indeed just 100 kilometers an hour, the speed of a car. And for ultra-low neutron scattering, you can literally walk next to the neutrons. So this is actually not a joke. This is really what we do. And in current neutron scattering research, some people are using ultra-low neutrons. They really slow them down until they really stop, and then you can catch them in a magnetic bottle and, of course, in a vacuum tube. So the speed of neutrons here, even at ANSTO, can be slowed down to really your walking speed. That's the velocity. Last but not least, energy. Energy is 1/2 mv squared. And I skip that point now here. Good exercise for you at home, actually, to calculate now the energy. The intermediate step gives you 2.381 times 10 to the power of minus 21 joule. And in our science, we typically calculate energies in terms of electron volt. So you have to divide that by the charge of the electron, 1.6 times 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb. And then you get 14.88 milli electron volt. That's the typical energy range of a neutron at a neutron experiment. Yeah, quick interruption again for cleaning the board. We used the wavelength 2.346 angstrom, calculated the momentum of a neutron, its velocity, And actually here, let me please correct that. 1,686 meter per second corresponds to 6,070 kilometers per hour. And finally, the energy, 14.88 millielectron volt. So these are two important values. The wavelength, 2.346 angstrom, corresponds to a typical distance between atoms, so that's an extremely well-suited wavelength to study crystallographic and magnetic structures in a material. The energy range of 14.8 millielectron volt corresponds to the typical energy of fundamental excitations in a solid, like lattice vibrations or magnetic vibrations. These are topics which you will hear about in third-year solid-state physics. So, as I mentioned, it's very important that you never mix up these equations for particle waves with the equations for light. And let me now just record the wavelength again, lambda 2.346 angstrom, and let's calculate the energy for an X-ray. For X-ray, for light, the following equation has to be used. Energy is Planck constant times frequency. So what is our frequency? The speed of light is lambda times frequency. Therefore, our frequency is speed of light in vacuum, typically, divided by lambda. Let's plug that in. 3 times 10 to the power of 8 meter per second divided by 2.346 angstrom. And an angstrom, as you remember, is 10 to the power of minus 10 meters. If we plug that in, then you get a frequency of 1.279 times 10 to the power of 18, 1 divided per second, or hertz. Our energy is the Planck constant, 6.626 times 10 to the power of minus 34 joule times second times our frequency, 1.279, 10 to the power of 18, 1 divided by second. Units are important. If you look at the units, second and 1 divided by second immediately cancels out. We get 8.473 times 10 to the power of minus 16 joule. As mentioned before, the typical energy unit here in diffraction and also in quantum mechanics is electron volt. So we have to divide by the charge of the electron. The charge of the electron is 1.6 times 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb ampere times seconds. And if you do that, you get a final energy of 5,296 electron volt, or roughly 5.3 kilo electron volt. calculation for light or X-ray is fundamentally different to the calculation for particle waves. Never ever mix this up. Let's compare. For X-ray, we have an energy range of 5,000 electron volt. For an electron beam, we would have an energy range in the order of a couple of electron volt. And for neutrons, we have an energy range of 15 milli electron volt, roughly. The energy range is totally different for these three. So, thank you very much.